Amen. Romans chapter 14. A number of weeks ago, I shared with you that the Holy Ghost dealt with me about us having Holy Ghost meetings all summer long in our Wednesday evening experiences. And I shared then that a Holy Ghost meeting is simply a meeting where the Holy Ghost fully has his way. That includes even in what we may do in a service. We may sing at this point, we may preach at this point, we may run, dance. We just want to simply be led of the Holy Ghost. And even more so than on a normal Sunday service or a normal service. And we're always open to the Holy Ghost, but there's a way he has you normally do things. And you usually follow that. He'll maybe adjust some things along the way. But then there are times where he just simply says, this is a time where I just want to run everything. I want everything to be almost spontaneous, on the spot. I want you to just follow my direction in this particular service, recognizing that's going to be a little different than what I normally have you do. And that's what we've been doing on Wednesday evenings. And as I shared a couple of weeks ago, Holy Ghost meetings are important to God. Dad Hagin said often that he was given an assignment to have Holy Ghost meetings during the last couple of years of his ministry, because if he didn't, they were in danger of being lost to this generation. So I had the privilege of being in a number of those Holy Ghost meetings. He had some of those meetings here at Word of Faith, and we experienced what God did then. And, of course, we're still experiencing what God does through the Holy Ghost and those type of meetings. And the reason why I've been so excited about these meetings is because I know that lives are going to be changed. In fact, I know lives have already been changed as a result of what God has done, and I believe he's going to continue to do that in the weeks to come. I did minister on this, like I said, a few weeks ago, and we simply talked about getting drunk in the Holy Ghost. We talked about that when the Spirit moves, things happen. And we also talked about that when the Spirit moves, we react. I mean, when the Spirit moves, you know, people sing. Sometimes they fall down. Sometimes they speak by the Holy Ghost. Sometimes they run. Sometimes they receive wisdom from God. Sometimes people get healed. Sometimes people laugh. Just as I was preparing today, I found some more instances where the hand of the Lord came on someone and they saw visions from God. Other instances where they were anointed by God to carry out a particular assignment that they had on the earth. And so we simply understood that the Holy Ghost will move from time to time and produce these supernatural results in the lives of those that are hungry for, that are thirsty for, that have pressed in to receive what God has for them. Tonight we're going to go a different direction. We're going to look at Romans chapter 14. I hope you're expecting tonight. I love something that Mark Hankins says. He says the Holy Ghost can do in 5 minutes what it would take you 5 years to do. Right? That, you know, in 5 minutes he can do what it's 5 years of counseling couldn't do. So I hope you came expecting tonight. You need to shake off whatever was happening during the week, or shake off whatever lies Satan's been planting in your mind. Shake off those negative emotions you've been dealing with all day and just say, God, I'm ready. I'm thirsty. The Bible talks about how God will pour out water on those who are thirsty. Well, water in this instance represents the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. It represents the Holy Ghost falling in this place. So if you're thirsty, get ready to drink. Come on now. I said, if you're thirsty, get ready to drink. If you're ready, get ready for God to move in this place tonight. Because see, God loves it when people will press their way to come hear from him. And when they'll press their way to get in the presence of God like this. God loves it when we do this. And it's in settings like this that we see spectacular moves of God. That we see things we haven't necessarily seen before. That we get that wisdom that we would not have gotten if we had stayed home and sat on our couch and watched television tonight. So I'm here to tell you that since God is ready to do some things, you ought to be expecting God to do some things here tonight. I'm here to tell you God wants us to laugh and to dance and to shout and to sing. Because the Spirit has moved in this place. He wants us full with joy in the Holy Ghost. Come on, Romans 14, 17. Here in Romans 14, Paul's making a very important point, talking about not judging your brother just because they may not be completely in agreement with you doctrinally. There's a whole message there, but part of what he's talking about is some believers believe that there were some types of food that you shouldn't eat. that it was sin to eat. And he said they were weak in the faith, but at the same time, when you get around them, don't eat that food. Out of love, just respect where they were, where they are. He actually said the same type of thing about people who believe in going to church on Saturday versus honoring God every day. So his whole point is don't judge your brethren and don't do something that's going to harm them. Of course, a little different when it comes to the days, but the principle is the same. And then he brings home his point in verse 17. For the kingdom of God, how many are in the kingdom of God? How many are excited to be in the kingdom of God? We've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light, the kingdom of God. But learn something about life in the kingdom. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink. As many translations say, it's not a matter of meat and drink. I would simply say it's simply not about meat and drink. It's not about what you can and can't eat, what you can or can't drink. A lot of times we think it's about all these rules and regulations. But then he tells us what the kingdom of God is about, but righteousness. Right standing before God and really right acting, right living before God. And peace. Thank God we can have peace, not just absence of war, but absence of anxiety, absence of lack. And we could show that from the Word of God in so many different ways. But then notice the last thing he says here, and joy. Joy, don't skip that. Joy. That word joy means cheerfulness. That word joy means gladness. It's translated elsewhere, exceeding joy. Joy, I just love that the kingdom of God is about joy. I mean, come on. You can say a lot of things that the kingdom of God is about, but God said the kingdom of God is about joy. It's about having a smile on your face. It's about gladness. Glory to God. It's about joy in the Holy Ghost. So joy in the Holy Ghost, meaning as one translation says in a scripture very similar to this, joy inspired by the Holy Ghost. He's the one that gives joy. He's the one that brings joy, right? Even the fruit of the Spirit, the harvest of the Spirit is joy. You know what Galatians 5:22 teaches? Well, joy in the Holy Ghost is kingdom culture. Come on, now we got to be reminded of this. As I was meditating on this, Lord was reminding me. I was getting beat up, so it's time for you to get beat up. Come on. I was getting reminded. It's time for you to get reminded. Joy is kingdom culture. That's the culture of the kingdom. Come on, we've all worked in places where the culture wasn't too good. You know, you work there and you're looking over your shoulder. You work there and you don't know who's going, you know, when somebody's going to jump down somebody's throat. You're not thrilled about this. You know, people are getting stabbed in the back. But in the kingdom of God, the culture is joy. You come to work with a smile on your face and a pep in your step. You might skip around that place. Glory to God. That's the culture in the kingdom. Anybody in the kingdom in this place today? So you ought to be somebody that's full of joy because that's what the kingdom is all about. It's about you enjoying joy as a result of the Holy Ghost. Joy in the Holy Ghost. Go with me, if you would, to Luke chapter 15. Now, I don't know how long I'm going to be ministering to you tonight, but I want you to get what we have to say. And the Holy Ghost just might interrupt at any point. And if he deals with your heart and he says run, then run. If you need to get up and shout, then shout. You need to get up and do a cartwheel, then do a cartwheel. We had that happen a couple years ago, one of our ministers' conferences. Whatever it takes, man, you just flow with the Holy Ghost. But get a hold of what God's saying. The kingdom of God is about joy. We think of the kingdom of God, we think about, you know, seriousness, and thank God for that. But come on now. Heaven does its serious business in the atmosphere of joy. Come on, Luke chapter 15. Jesus is teaching about going after, leaving the 99 to get to the one. That's a good church growth message right there. But verse 7, in fact, we'll back up to verse 4. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he had found it, he laid it on his shoulders, doing what? Rejoicing. The word rejoicing here simply means to be cheerful. He's happy. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, what? Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. Now, this is a strange reason to call a party. Right? It's a strange reason to tell everybody, come on over, hang out with me. Come on, rejoice with me. I mean, many of us will do that tomorrow for Independence Day, or we do it for other reasons. But here he's simply saying, I lost one sheep and I found that sheep. Come rejoice. Well, let's have a party about this sheep. Anybody ever been to a sad party? I haven't. I've been to a lot of parties. I have never been to a sad party. All right, you go to a party, I don't care if it's a one-year-old's birthday party, you're happy, you're smiling, you go, oh, isn't she cute, or you're doing something. Here he's talking about having a party because one was lost and it was found. Jesus has given them this parable to make a point. Verse 7, I say unto you that likewise what?
Joy.
Likewise what?
Joy.
Joy shall be in heaven. Take a moment, let that sink in. Joy in heaven. C.S. Lewis said something. He said, heaven does its most serious business in the atmosphere of joy. Come on, heaven is full of joy. In heaven, they are laughing. People are shouting. You know that in the throne room, they are shouting. We find scriptures that reveal that to us. In heaven, people are dancing. In heaven, people are singing. People are really, the heaven is full of joy. And Jesus reveals to us one of the ways that a heavenly joy party gets started in heaven, and that is when even one sinner repenteth. Well, wait, hey, there are sinners repenting all the time. I mean, if you think about it, the body of Christ is getting somebody saved every day throughout the world. I mean, our ministry alone gets over 10,000 people saved every year, or saved or rededicated every year. How about all the many others that God is using? Heaven is rejoicing all the time. Heaven is full of joy all the time. Heaven is laughing and shouting and singing all the time. Heaven is full of joy. Go to Isaiah 61. You know, later on in Luke 15, the Bible talks about how there's joy in the presence. And one translation says among and in the presence of the angels. So the angels are some of those individuals who are full of joy. But Isaiah chapter 61. A lot of times we'll look at a scripture like that and we'll say, well, that's good news for when I get to heaven. And it is. I mean, you know, if heaven wasn't full of joy, once you showed up, you make sure it was, I'm sure. I made it! Woo! Hallelujah! There's Abraham, there's David, there's Jesus! Yeah! Some of you go, hey, I have no more pain. I'm looking good. The streets are gold. There's my estate. There's the throne room. There's my mother. There's my brother. Woo! But you know, people are going to heaven. They're arriving all the time. Oh, every time a believer passes away, Paul said their body is just sleeping, but their spirit is present with God. And they're absent here, they're present there. They have new arrivals all the time. There's a train pulling up all the time, and those people are jumping out saying, whoa, I made it. There's Jesus. I made it. Heaven is full of joy. Come on, Isaiah 61. Verse 1. Notice what Jesus said. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy, to give unto them the oil of joy. Jesus came to give unto us the oil of joy. See, heaven is not just full of joy. Heaven is constantly pouring out joy. Oh, I don't know if you heard what I just said. See, oil represents an anointing. Heaven is constantly pouring out joy. So see, when the Holy Ghost rains on a place, when the Holy Ghost falls, when the Spirit gets to moving, part of what happens when the Holy Ghost does those things is that joy shows up. People start to get full of joy, and they run, and they shout, and they dance, and they sing because of joy on them. Even in Hebrews 1, the Bible talks about Jesus, and it says that God anointed him with the oil of gladness. So when we think of Jesus, we think of somebody who maybe walked on the earth and, you know, was always serious, when in reality he was a joyful guy. And he's a joyful guy right now. He's got a smile on his face, not just frown on his face. He's somebody that laughs easily, and we ought to be people that have a smile on our face. We ought to be people that laugh easily. We ought to be people that are glad all the time. And part of the reason why we ought to be that way is because of what he's already done for us. But part of what helps us with that is that God has made the oil of joy available to us. If you made Jesus Lord of your life, joy is already in your spirit. But then when you get in a setting like this, man, joy just happens to be poured out on you. And if you'll yield to that, it'll cause what's in you to bubble up and overwhelm those negative emotions, overwhelm that depression, overwhelm even that pain in your body, and help you to experience the culture of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Go to Philippians chapter 4. There is joy in heaven, and because of what Jesus did for us, there's joy on earth. And because you came to this place tonight thirsty, come on, because you came ready for God to move, I'm here to tell you there's joy in this place. If you just pay attention to yourself, God's stirring up the joy on the inside of you, calling you to forget those things that you were worried about and letting that joy to bubble up and take over your brain and take over your emotions and take over your life like it should. Come on, Philippians chapter 4. Come on, God wants us to laugh, to shout, to dance, to sing. Laugh, shout, dance, sing. Laugh, shout, dance, sing, laugh, dance, shout, sing. Come on, I messed it up. That's even funny. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Woo! See, some of y'all starting to get it. Some of you just sitting there like, what's going on? But there's joy in this place. You ought to laugh and shout and dance and sing unto the Lord. Hallelujah! Come on, Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Laugh, shout, dance, sing. Laugh, shout, dance, sing. Laugh, shout, dance, sing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Hallelujah. Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. Always. When? You ought to always have your finger on the joy trigger. Come on now. You ought to always be at the starting line waiting for the gun to fire. You ought to always be ready to just to rejoice and break out and give God praise. Rejoice in the Lord always. Notice something about that phrase, always. It implies that you should rejoice in spite of your circumstances. That you should rejoice no matter how you feel right now. That you should rejoice, you should rejoice, you should rejoice, you should rejoice all the time. All the time. All the time. Hallelujah. All the time. Come on. History tells us Paul was in a prison, possibly in a prison where there really was no sewer. He may have been up to his knees, up to his waist. and things you don't even want to touch. Yet he had revelation. In fact, he talked about it multiple places. He talked about people who, because they've received Jesus, had joy. Peter talked about a group of people that had joy unspeakable and full of glory just because Jesus came. And here Paul is in a prison writing, "Rejoice in the Lord always." I don't think he wrote this feeling sad. I don't think he wrote this with a frown on his face. I don't think he wrote this holding his nose. He wrote this saying, "I got the joy of the Holy Ghost on the inside of me. And even in this prison, I'm going to rejoice. And if I can rejoice in this prison, you can rejoice wherever you are, no matter what's going on in your life. Because Jesus came, he died, he rose again. You're a child of God. Heaven is your home. And no matter what you're facing, you will win." Hallelujah! Woo! Hallelujah! He said, "Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors." If you're already more than a conqueror, then you don't have to wonder how I'm going to win. You already won. Everybody else may be on pins and needles wondering if you're going to win this day. But you already know this thing is won. You might as well do your dance before you get to the end zone. Host up your trophy, hoist your trophy of victory, and whatever your situation is, and just rejoice in the Lord. Some of you saying, "Well, Pastor, I need a little help with that." Go to Luke chapter 6. Come on, man. This is important for us to do as believers. Smith Wigglesworth said he used to wake up every morning, jump out of bed, and do a hard dance for 10 to 12 minutes. That's just how he woke up. Why? Jesus came. Jesus rose. I mean, come on, I'm on the winning side. We ought to have that same attitude. I know it's not easy. I was moping around myself today. You know, and walking around, and then the Lord had me get into these scriptures and said, "Now look, what did I teach you? What did he teach me?" He taught me to be somebody that will laugh and to shout and to dance and to sing. Now, you can't mope your victory in. You can't mope your change in. You can't mope your future in. You got to shout it in. You got to dance it in. You got to praise it in. You got to be an individual that's going to be in joy. And when you're operating in joy, God will turn things around. Come on, Luke chapter 6. Hallelujah. Let me show you something about our God. Come on, I love what something that Mark Hagin says. If you only knew what happens in the spirit when you rejoice, you will rejoice every day. Because while you're rejoicing here, there's something happening there. And it's true, man. You start rejoicing here, praising God, dancing. You're doing it in faith. Faith laughs at impossibilities. You're doing it in faith, and that faith is what's allowing God to move in your life, in your situation. So when you understand that the only thing that's keeping me from my victory is my lack of faith, and if I'll just shout in faith, if I'll just rejoice in faith, God can bring me my victory. Well, you'll become very strategic about this thing. You'll say, "Well, I want victory, so let me rejoice. I want victory, so let me dance. I want victory, so let me laugh. Let me go ahead and do what the Bible says, and God will be able to use my faith." Come on, Luke chapter 6. Let me help some of y'all that are still looking at things and instead of just rejoicing. Come on, man. You got to laugh, shout, dance, sing, laugh. Shout, dance, sing, laugh, shout, dance, sing. You may not be able to sing at all, but sing a joyful noise, man. But just do it out of joy. It should be a joyful noise, right? Come on, Luke chapter 6. Let me show you something about God's nature. Some of you came here, you're still thinking about what I'm dealing with. And the devil has a way of making you feel like your situation has never been faced by anyone else. That your situation happens to be the type that even God can't fix. And sometimes even when you're a word-taught person, you like to start throwing scriptures out and talking about free will and all this stuff. And that's why God can't do it because, you know, he don't interfere with people. But he's still God. I think I shared Sunday how there's a person in my life that's close to me and how they've been believing God for some things. And if you had asked me how they would get there, I couldn't have told you how they would get there a couple years ago. But God has done some things. He's brought stuff out of left field. I mean, you know, if you sat down and wrote a list of 100 ways God could do this, this would not end up on your list. You know what I'm saying? He's done a couple of things like that. And here I am looking at them, enjoying what God has done. And it encouraged me. It said to me, I may not understand it. I may know a lot of scripture, but I don't know everything. But I do know God. And I know that God is a God who, if he has said something to you, he's going to do what it takes to bring it to pass. And he's going to find a way. If he's got to find a loophole, he will find a loophole. But he's going to get this thing done. I may not know what, but I know whom. I may not know when, but I know soon. Woo! So I can laugh and I can shout and I can dance and I can sing. Come on, Luke chapter 6, verse 21. Ha 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 ha. Woo! Some of y'all, what are they laughing about? You're going to get it. But see, when the Holy Ghost starts moving like this, you got to jump in the river. He is a gentleman. He is not going to grab you and shake you and make you laugh and get happy. But boy, the presence of God is in this place, man. I mean, God has poured out the oil of gladness in this place. And if you'll just yield to it, sometimes you got to just start out in the flesh. You have one of those silly laughs. Ha, ha. Ha, ha, ha. Ha, ha, and before you know it, you'll be on the floor. Ha, 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 the Holy Ghost will help you out. But if you're dealing with something, this is the time to jump in. This is what you came for. Sometimes you just need to have the burden removed and the yoke destroyed. Sometimes your mind just needs to get set free. And what a help that happens when you let what's on the inside of you get loose, man. Let that joy bubble up and just take over. And a lot of times when you're doing that, all of a sudden God can get you that answer you've been looking for. I'll keep trying to read Luke chapter 6. And I'm just trying to show you a real simple thing. We may never read it, who knows? I'm sorry, I tried to hang in there as long as I could. The future is bright. I said the future is bright. Your future is bright. Come on. You got to learn to look at the God side. Go to James chapter 1. Let me go there. We like I said, we may never read Luke 6. You know, you read on your own. I don't know. Thank you, Holy Ghost. James chapter 1. Laugh, shout, dance, sing. Come on, look. James chapter 1, verse 2. Woo! My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Well, man, let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. But this is a strange way to look at trouble. One translation says you are hedged about with, I guess we would say, difficulties. You don't just have one thing going wrong. You got all kinds of stuff going wrong. I mean, you're looking this way, and oh my goodness, looking that, and look at this, and you know, everything's going wrong. And then God says, count it all joy because it's building your patience. The trying of your faith, by the way, not the circumstance, but the decision is contented to stay in faith, which is part of what's happening when you're counting your joy, is helping build your patience, and your patience will get you to a place where you have no lack. In other words, instead of having all this trouble, you'll look around and have nothing lacking. Strange way of looking at trouble. A lot of times we hear people say, look at the bright side of things. But I want to encourage you to look at the God side of things. Because God doesn't look at your trouble like you look at your trouble. You winning is a foregone conclusion. I mean, he's not even looking at it saying, you know, count it all joy because I'm going to give you victory. Well, we know that. He said, does promise that. But here he's saying, count it all joy, knowing the trying of your faith, work and patience. Not only are you going to have victory, you're going to be perfect and entire, lacking nothing. There are times when we got to stop looking at a problem like we look at it and look at the God side. Look at it how God looks at it. There's a way he's looking at it. He's saying that, hey, man, yeah, you've been under attack, but look what's going to happen at the end of this. Look at the victory I'm going to give you. Look at the testimony I'm going to give you. And because you stayed in my word, you're coming out wiser and stronger and better. And you'll be an individual that can walk in victory. And what the enemy meant to destroy you will be used to destroy him. What the enemy meant for evil, God will turn to your good. He tried to take you out in one area, and you're going to take him out of your life in every area. Look at the God side. And when you do, man, you can't help but rejoice. All right, go back to Luke chapter 6. Let's try it again. Come on. Laugh. Shout. Dance. Sing. Laugh. Shout. Dance. Sing. You know, there are times you ought to be laughing, shouting, dancing, and singing. At home.
Yes, sir.
I mean, you don't have to be in a setting like this for the Holy Ghost to fall. He can fall in your bedroom while you're praying. He can fall in the kitchen if that's where you pray. He can fall in the car. You ought to be somebody that's pressing in and that's deciding that I'm going to rejoice. And as you rejoice, God will show up.
Hallelujah.
And it's something to be in a bad situation and find yourself laughing. But the Bible said in James chapter 5, it said you will laugh at famine and destruction.
Amen.
Come on, you know what famine is? There's no food. You know what destruction is? Everything's falling apart, and here you are laughing with your silly self. Ha, 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 ha. People are looking at you like, what's wrong with you? Ha, 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 ha. Because you believe in your God. You know what he said. You know what he can do. You know what he is doing. You know he's cheering for you. Wasn't that what Luke chapter 5 was revealing to us? Heaven's watching to see one person repent. And when they repent, they have a party. They were cheering for that person. Well, God didn't just cheer for you when you were a sinner trying to get you saved. He's cheering for you now as a saint, as a child of God who's living out the destiny he has for you. And every time you win, heaven's cheering, man. And God is the one that's stepping in and he's cheating a little bit. He's helping you out here and helping you out there. He's excited about helping you get to the plan he had for your life. So, man, if that's how God views it, we might as well agree with God.
Yeah.
We might as well, hey, cheer about what God's going to do. Cheer about it because we know it's already done. Because we know our God.
Glory.
Come on, if he did it before. Isn't that the song we sang on Sunday? Same God right now that was back then, right? Come on, many of us, have we been here before? We get amnesia sometimes. We forget how bad it was last time. We forget how we felt last time. We forget how we wanted to quit last time. We forget what other people said last time. And yet in the middle of that, somehow, whether it was right out of left field, God stepped in and you came out. And you came out victorious. You came out stronger. You came out better. And here, I'm here to tell you, if he did it before, he will do it again. Listen, there's nothing in this situation that God can't handle, just like there was nothing in your last situation that God can't handle. He's got you. Do you understand me? He's got you. He's got you. He's not one bit worried about it. You don't need to be either. You just need to laugh and to shout and to dance and to sing. Luke 6, verse 21. Just notice how God works. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for you shall be filled. These are scriptures we're very familiar with, but I want you to get just how God works. Blessed are you that weep now. The word weep, one of the meanings for it is to wail. We think of weeping, we think about somebody crying silently. No, this is wailing. It says you're wailing now. But blessed are you. This word blessed means happy and to be envied. Why? Why am I blessed when I'm wailing? Because you have a future. for you shall laugh. You're going to sit back and laugh in joy and satisfaction. Whatever had you wailing before has been taken care of, and now you are full of victory and joy and laugh. That's the God we serve that can cause you to have go from mourning to having the oil of joy in your life. That can cause you to go from weeping to laughing. In fact, go to John chapter 16. Hallelujah. 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 Notice what Jesus said to the disciples in verse 20. I'm just going to read it to you. We did get to Luke 6, didn't we? John chapter 16, verse 20. Verily, verily, I say to you that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice, and you shall be sorrowful. Some of you might be sitting in a situation like that right now. But your sorrow shall be turned into what?
Joy.
Some of y'all need to grab a hold of that.
Joy.
You need to grab a hold of that, put that on your refrigerator. My sorrow will be turned into joy. What does that mean? My situation is going to turn. I like that. Shall be turned into joy. Turn. God can turn things around. God can change things. He can turn things. Verse 22, and you now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again and your heart shall rejoice. You have sorrow now, but your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. No man taketh it from you. Notice again, he's talking about sorrow, but then he's talking about rejoicing. In fact, go with me if you will to Job chapter 8. Come on, come on, come on. He's saying you're happy. You're to be envied because your future is bright. So man, you ought to be full of joy. You ought to laugh and shout and dance and sing. Job chapter 8. Find Psalms and go backwards a little bit. Or just look on the screen. God bless you. It's all right. Sometimes I'll be ready to look on the screen myself. I was doing that Sunday. I was like, Haggai. And I'm like, Haggai. Good Lord, why can't I find Haggai? I'm up here preaching. I can't find. Then I found Haggai. Woo! Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was about to be going, Haggai, chapter 2, verse. Come on, Job chapter 8. Verse 20, it says, behold, God will not cast away a perfect man, a righteous man. Neither will he help the evildoers. What's he going to do? Till he fill your mouth with laughing and your lips with rejoicing. The Hebrew says you will be shouting for joy. So God's saying, I'm not going to cast you away. I'm going to keep working in your life until... See that? Until I fill your mouth. See, there's a difference between a little laugh. You know, somebody tells a bad joke and they want you to laugh and you ha-ha. And your mouth being filled with laughter. You ever fall down laughing? I mean, you laughing so hard. You know, that's the thing about having kids, man. Every couple of days, somebody's going to say something or do something and you just going to lose it. I think I had it happen to me yesterday. I'm just cracking up. And that's what you're talking about, being filled with laughter. He says, I'm going to fill your mouth with laughing and your lips with rejoicing. You're going to be laughing and shouting. Well, here it is right here, man. Laugh and shout and dance and sing. How's this going to happen? I'm going to turn things around. See, you're going to be laughing and shouting because he came and died for you. You're going to be laughing and shouting and dancing and singing because you believe what he said. But the day is coming where you're going to be laughing and shouting and dancing and singing because what he said to you has actually come to pass. Because you have gone from amen to there it is. Because now you're singing hallelujah and not just saying, you know, if he did it before, he'll do it again. Now you're singing, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. You're celebrating that he did do it again in your life. Because that's the kind of God he is. So you might as well already laugh and dance and shout and sing. You might as well already be happy about it. Because that's the God that you serve. Go to Psalm 126. Somebody say laugh. Shout. dance,
sing.
Say it again, laugh,
shout,
dance,
sing.
When the Spirit moves, man, you should just be ready to laugh and to dance and to shout and to sing. And a lot of times all he's doing is just getting you to where you should have been all along. Getting a meeting like this, and it's just the Holy Ghost just bubbles up and gets you to doing what you should have been doing. But thank God for mercy. And thank God we can come together like this, and God can drop his Spirit in this place, and his fire can fall and get us stirred up again and remind us again so we can walk out of here full, our joy on full instead of on empty.
Yes, sir.
Laughing and smiling and dancing and singing unto God. Hallelujah.
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 Indeed, this is what happens when the Spirit moves. I love Psalm 126. Verse 1, it says, when the Lord. Not if. There's no if in your future. There's a when in your future. Oh, you didn't hear what I just said. I said there's a when in your future. There is a date on the calendar when what God said will have come to pass. You didn't hear what I just said. I said there is a date on the calendar. Come on, hallelujah. When what God has said will come to pass. We get that. I mean, hey, I'm celebrating a birthday tomorrow. Well, glory to God. I know there's a date on the calendar every year where I'm getting older. That used to be exciting. Not so much anymore. But that's all right. But I'm here to tell you there's a date on the calendar that heaven knows. That says, hey, man, that's the day when I'm going to actually turn this thing. That's the day when they're going to look up and say, look what the Lord has done. That's the day when they're going to run and tell their family and friends, come together and celebrate with me. Because what God said has come to pass in my life. When the Lord, there is a day that is coming where you're going to celebrate your victory. How do we celebrate when God moves? How do we celebrate when the Spirit falls? When the Lord, it's going to be supernatural, the Lord's doing it, turned again. I like that phrase because it points to a turning point. This might be your turning point tonight. You were in fear and depression, and God's gotten you back into a place of faith and joy. I mean, the Bible talks about what God can do with just the faith the size of a mustard seed. And the problem is, a lot of times we don't even give him that faith. But when you do, now mountains start moving. Now money starts coming. Now victories start manifesting. And see, and this is just a time of expressing your faith. When you're operating in joy, you're expressing your faith, and there is no penalty for excessive celebration.
Hallelujah.
In the kingdom of God. You can express your faith all you want.
Amen.
And praise God and rejoice in advance, and now things can turn.
Wow.
When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, they were captives. We were like them that dream. You know, God will produce too good to be true scenarios in your life. I mean, the Bible talks about in Proverbs, I believe, chapter 13, when desire cometh, it is a tree of life. When desire cometh. And he said, if you delight in the Lord, I'll give you the desires of your heart. But that scripture goes a step farther. When it comes, it's as a tree of life. Yeah, there's going to be some too good to be true scenarios. Look up and say, God, this is even better. If I had wrote this out myself, it wouldn't have been as good as what you've done. I mean, Ecclesiastes talks about how you hardly remember the days of your life. Your time, because things are so good. Time's flying because you're having fun. That's what they're saying. They're testifying. When he turned it, it was like we were dreaming. It was like we were dreaming. You almost want to pinch yourself. Can this even be true? Well, God's not a respecter of persons. If he did it for them,
He will do it for you. If he did it for servants of God, he will do it for sons of God. If you would just believe him for it, and if you'll just rejoice like you believe. Hallelujah. You didn't hear what I just said. I said, and if you'll rejoice like you believe it. If you'll rejoice like you believe it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Desire cometh. We've said money cometh. Some people are saying mate cometh. That's desire coming for them. But desire cometh. What I'm desiring is coming. It's coming right now. It cometh. I mean, it's in the process. It's finding its way to me. It's going down the road. It's looking for my address. It cometh. 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 That's another laugh and the dance and the shout about. What did he say here? He said, then was our mouth filled with laughter. Ha ha! Come on, you ever laugh because things worked out? You're so happy you just start laughing. Folks, look at you. What's wrong with them? I'm happy. Ha 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 ha! Woo! Ha ha ha! I'm just laughing. You be walking down the street, just start laughing, folks. Ha ha! Why are you laughing? Because God worked it out. Ha-ha! You're in the grocery store and people getting their food. You go, ha-ha! They all jumping. What's going on? Ha! Jesus has worked. He's made a way. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready. This is what great grace is all about. It's about causing the power of God to fall in your life and bring about great results. Desire coming, victory showing up, and you laughing and dancing and shouting and singing unto God. Come on now. If you haven't experienced great grace yet, I'm here to tell you, you just entered the second half of the greatest year of your life, and you better dance and shout in the victory God has for you. Glory to God! Great grace is falling. It's falling. It's falling on you. And there is nothing the devil can do to stop it in your life. So you might as well be like somebody that dreams. You might as well laugh about your victory. And you might as well sing about your victory. You might as well get out and dance a little bit, praising God for your victory. You might as well shout unto God because of your victory. Because great grace is bringing you victory. Glory to God. Come on, if you can't get happy tonight, you might not be alive. We might need to raise you from the dead and get you laughing in this place. Hallelujah! 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 Come on, go to Psalm 132, a page over. I'm about done, I guess. Boy, this has been a power-packed hour. Glory to God. Shh. Shh. Woo! Ha, 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 ha. Oh! Ho, ho! Come on, it's like the clouds have parted and I can see the sun again. Your future is bright. I said it's bright. It's brighter than your past. It's brighter than you can imagine. Desire cometh. Great grace is bringing desire. Desire into your life. And some of you, man, that's family members that you've been believing God for a long time. To step up. But you've been praying. You've been praying in the Holy Ghost. You've been supplicating for them. You believe what God said, that your prayers avail much and desire cometh. A lot of our desires are kingdom desires, dreams God's put on the inside of us that we feel like they've been on pause, they've been on hold, but you've been faithful and desire cometh. Listen, whatever, come on, you ever been in a pool and you take a ball? And this is just Holy Ghost talk, just showing me this. This is for me just as much as it is for y'all. And you push it down in the water. You are preventing the ball from doing what it should be doing. It should float on the water. But because you're pushing it down, it can't do what it's made to do. But at some point, you can't hold it down anymore. And when you end up letting it go, the ball just don't go back to where it was. It's got some ground to make up now. So instead of it just bouncing back, it bounces up. It might pop you in the head in the process, but it's gonna bounce up and come. Some of y'all been held back. Some of you, the devil did it. Some of you did it. Some of you other folk did it. But I'm here to tell you, if you decided to be faithful and to rejoice, the enemy's been holding you down, but he can't do it no more. It's a year of great grace. You're not just going to go where you were supposed to go. God's going to get back everything you lost. God's going to take you where you should be. It's going to bounce back in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God restores years. He restores lost money. He restores lost things. He's been doing it from the beginning, and he's going to do it in your life. So don't ever let the devil tell you that you've lost something doing what God said. You might have been delayed. You might have been hindered. You might have been pushed down. But when it's all said and done, you're going to look back and say, it was like the devil was never there. God brought everything as he said. It just means that when it happened, it was bigger, it was stronger, it was faster than it would have been if he hadn't interfered. Glory to God. Glory to God. You know, I'm starting to understand why people say, how do you end these services? I don't know. Shh, come on, lift your hands. Lift your hands. Shh. Ha, 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 ha. Ha, 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 ha. Come on, if you believe what the Holy Ghost has said tonight, a lot of this, not written on a piece of paper, man. It's just the Holy Ghost. You just go ahead and praise God for it right now. Some of you, this time, it's time to laugh right now. Time to dance right now. Time to shout right now. Time to sing right now. Whatever it is, let God know you believe him. You accept this word that he's spoken to you. You expect the victory he's promised you. Let him know you are completely out of the doubt zone. And you are now fully in the faith zone. No more doubt. No more fear. No more depression. No more complaining. Only believing. Only rejoicing. Only shouting. Only dancing. Only singing. Only laughing. Ha, ha, ha. Oh, glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Thank you. Ha, ha, ha. Woo! Come on, praise him. You're not ain't worried about what comes next. Just praise him right now. Rejoice in the Lord. Because you believe. Because you know it's done. Because you know desire cometh. Thank you, Father. No, it's done. It's done. Nothing lost. Nothing lost. Nothing lost. That's what restoration is for. There is no loss. There is no lack. Everything he said will come to pass. Everything. Glory to God. Thank you, Father, for it. Ha ha. Ha ha. Ho ho ho. Glory to God. Ha ha ha. Oh. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. Come on, is this what somebody needed tonight? Did the Holy Ghost give you what you needed tonight? Well, man, I'm trying to move on. I'm trying. Glory to God. 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 Just rejoice just for a few more moments. Want to make sure everything the Holy Ghost wants done in this time is done. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. So we choose to laugh and to dance and to shout and to sing. Ha, 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 ha. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Glory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Woo, it's going to be so sweet. Gonna be like we're just like we're gonna be like we're dreaming. Saying, look what God has done. The Lord has done marvelous things.